Turnpike Sports is brought to you by Drizzly, your online liquor store. Available in over 95 cities across North America, Drizzly offers a huge selection and competitive pricing with a side of personalized content. Now there's no need to leave the house. Get alcohol delivered in less than an hour by Drizzly. Head on over to drizzly.com and order today. And now get $5 off your first order of $20 or more when using promo code DRINK19 at checkout. Shop beer, wine, and liquor with drizzly.com. Welcome to Turnpike Sports. I'm Dave Weishaddle, and as always, I'm joined by my producer and co-host, Doug Weishaddle. Doug, we're finally done with this Brady Belichick crap, and now we can get back to actual real-life football games without the drama.
I'll tell you, it was, for a while there, it was almost like you forgot about the football game leading up to it. It was just all Brady Belichick, who was better, who was responsible. You know, who did what to whom, and if any of that stuff behind the scenes is true, fine, whatever. I don't know. No one knows.
This is getting weird in the Boston sports radio realm. Now they're looking at, oh, it was a moral victory. Now they're actually looking for losses and looking for silver linings in these terrible dark clouds of losses. So what a change in attitude now.
Well, speaking as...
And by the way, Patriots, you're tied with the Jets.
Speaking as a fan of the Jets, who's been going through looking for silver linings for at least 5 to 8 of my 40 years as a Jets fan, you got to look for anything to help keep you going.
I have to admit,
watching the game, because I had to watch, I wanted to see exactly this kid. I really haven't watched Mac Jones too much. They had some good segments with. I know he set like a one of the longest 19 in a row.
19 completions,
but they were all short. They were all short.
Good for him. But you know what? Take that, and now you got to start winning games. Okay, that's my point in this Boston radio saying, you know what? We feel good about a loss. No, you shouldn't be feeling good about a loss. Okay,
the one
you feel
weird
good
thing,
you have a quarterback, but you know what? You see, there's a lot more work to do. I mean, it's such a change in attitude now.
I have to admit, after seeing their offseason, bringing in all those people that they did, that they brought in, the Patriots and the two tight ends that they brought in, I don't really see an impact those tight ends are having in this offense.
Well, they scored twice during the game.
Other than that, I mean, the other games, Hunter Henry, I was surprised to see him catch a touchdown pass. He doesn't seem like a red zone threat at all to me.
Well, speaking of losses, I lost that game because I thought the Buccaneers would blow out the Patriots. I got to be honest with you. I didn't even look at the weather forecast. I didn't even count on the rain being
hard. Didn't that interview with Logan Fields tell you that you should always look at the weather for your betting?
Didn't look at the weather.
I'm actually waiting for some snows to come in with New England and even Green Bay and all that. I'm looking forward to snow football.
Okay, well, that's tough betting.
Yes.
Well, we got a great show for you. We got a Bet in the House Beat in the House segment. See, now my head is in the betting area. So we got a Beat in the House segment. We have a Week 5 NFL picks coming up. We have our book report. And I get to talk with Mike Seeley from Better Collective. We're going to be talking horse racing and fantasy weather, believe it or not. It's been a busy week in sports, so let's take a trip down the turnpike. Today's trip down the turnpike is brought to you by Drizzly, your online liquor store. Available in over 95 cities across North America, Drizzly offers a huge selection and competitive pricing with a side of personalized content. Now there's no need to leave the house. Get alcohol delivered in less than an hour by Drizzly. Head on over to drizzly.com and order today. And now get $5 off your first order of $20 or more when using our promo code DRINK19 at checkout. Shop beer, wine, and liquor with drizzly.com.
Exit 1.
Well, it seems to be that time of year where the Sports Betting Hall of Fame class inductees are announced.
All right. Okay.
Now, as a lot of people in the sports betting industry know, the Sports Betting Hall of Fame is part of the SBC Summit North America conference that's being held up in MetLife Stadium at the end of November, November 30th, December 1st, that sort of date. The induction ceremony is December 1st this year.
Great, great.
They've got five inductees.
All right.
Yolanda Acuna, she's the former director of administration for MGM Resorts. Joe Asher, the former CEO of William Hill US, who is now the president of sports betting at IGT.
Okay.
He was just hired, or just appointed, they say. We also have Johnny Avella.
All right, DraftKings, right?
Yep, Director of Race and Sportsbook Operations from DraftKings. Joe Brennan Jr., the former chair of Omega, who was very instrumental in getting the sports betting lawsuit started against the government for PASPA.
Yeah, no, he's the one of the guys that got the ball rolling.
And Jimmy Vaccaro, who we've had on the show before.
Absolutely. Yeah, we had Jimmy when he moved back to Pittsburgh for a little bit, but now he's back at South Point.
Yeah, he was doing one of the sports books out there. I believe it was...
I can't remember.
It was Rivers or one of the other ones out
okay,
there. So, yeah. But yeah, he was out in Pittsburgh for a while. Well, he's from the Pittsburgh area.
Yeah, yeah, no, that was kind of a homecoming for Jimmy.
And so, he was a great guest, by
yeah,
the way.
Absolutely.
So much fun to talk to. Great stories, too.
We got to have him back on. He's fun. We should have every one of these guys back on. So it's, you know.
Well, like I said.
Great to talk to. They are the... Sports betting wouldn't be successful as it is without these five people. So congratulations to them all.
Well, I took a look at some of the backgrounds of some of these inductees.
Okay.
Mostly the one I was most surprised at, and this is basically because, you know, maybe I'm not too up to speed on a lot of the history of the sports betting industry, especially in Vegas. Yolanda Acuna, she's listed as the former director of administration at MGM Resorts. And by the way, if you go to the Sports Betting Hall of Fame's website,
okay,
all you have to do is search it. It's part of SBC's websites. They have a Sports Betting Hall of Fame history of all the different inductees, as well as also the current members too of the Hall of Fame. One thing I noticed, and Yolanda was from a 39-year member of the sports betting industry.
Wow, okay.
She started out at Club Cal Neva in Reno, Nevada, then opened the was part of the opening of the book at Steve Wynn's The Mirage in 1989.
Okay.
One little note here. As the director of administration, I'm reading directly from her bio that they published on the website. At the peak of her tenure, she managed 15 properties, including 13 in Las Vegas.
Hmm.
I mean, she had a storied career, and it's actually really nice to see someone of this stature being inducted at this point into the Hall of Fame.
Well, look, I actually found it. sbcevents.com/hall-of-fame/. So check it out.
I'm surprised they don't have a domain name for that yet. SBC Hall or something, you know. But she actually learned under the tutelage of Jimmy Vaccaro.
Oh, okay.
You know, to run the books. So, kind of interesting. And
Well, like I said, I mean, these five are really, you know, really helped make sports betting what it is today. So, you know, well-earned induction. So congratulations to all of them.
And just so people know, the Hall of Fame ceremony will take place on the second evening of the SBC Summit North America.
Oh, and which we will be there, right?
Exactly.
Okay.
December 1st, 2021.
All right.
The induction ceremony is taking place at the Coaches Club at MetLife Stadium in East Rutherford, New Jersey. sports fans, Jets and Giants Stadium.
Yep.
So it's going to be kind of an interesting event. It's over in Secaucus, you know, where the Meadowlands are. So, you know, always great to see some of these big names inducted, especially people like Joe Brennan and Joe Asher. Joe Asher, William Hill, U.S., he was such an instrumental factor in getting sports betting moving across the country.
Sure, absolutely.
Now he's going to be running sports betting for IGT. That was a great hire by them.
Exit 2.
We're going to talk a little global expansion for esports today.
Okay.
The NBA 2K League has announced its first Mexico team.
Wow, okay. All right.
They did a deal with Dux Gaming, and Dux Gaming is an organization that fields teams to compete in video game titles and Spanish football leagues.
Okay.
So they're both esports and traditional.
Now, when you say Spanish football, you're talking about soccer.
Soccer.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Always soccer when we're talking. Most of the time, it's
just want to clear things up.
We're not talking American sports. We're talking soccer.
Just want to clear things up.
This will be the first NBA 2K league team in Latin America.
Wow. Great.
They have been expanding. They have not named the city yet in Mexico.
Okay.
But they will at a later date. But this will be a Mexican team, or a Mexico-based team, I should say, to play in the NBA 2K League. This is the second expansion team that the NBA 2K has done. They did the addition of Gen G Tigers of Shanghai in 2020. Okay. So this is the second expansion of the NBA 2K League. The NBA 2K League was, I think, kind of thrust into the spotlight because of the pandemic, too.
I think a lot of these leagues, I mean, I've watched more NBA 2K on TV. I've watched more NASCAR virtual racing. So many virtual sports. Is that the right term, virtual sports?
Yes.
Okay,
do virtual sports. That's another way of saying it, yes.
Esports. So, no, it's, you know, when sports stopped, I think they filled the gap for a lot of people who wanted to watch sports, and it's great. I mean, certainly a lot of people got hooked, and I'm one of them. I think it's a lot of fun watching.
I have to admit, the NBA 2K League during their regular season was actually kind of more fun to watch than some of the NBA games, because regular season NBA is just, let's get to the playoffs kind of thing.
Yeah, yeah. Well, the one great thing about NBA 2K is there's no load management concept.
No.
So
I don't know how you load manage
there's no load
digitized
management
players.
Thing,
so, but
good.
But, yeah, this will be the 24th team for the NBA 2K League. Again, team name, city, logo will be announced at a later date. And the league has already been conducting international qualifying events in Hong Kong, London, Seoul, Shanghai for the top players for their European and Asia-Pacific regions. So NBA 2K has been expanding like crazy.
I got to tell you, it's a great way to get the NBA product out there. And it's really, I think, building an audience and overseas. And so I think it's great. It's a great marketing tool.
You know what it also does?
Yeah.
Creates another revenue stream for the NBA.
Oh, absolutely.
Exit 3.
Continuing on the expansion theme we have here, the Professional Fighters League is expanding.
Okay.
The Professional Fighters League entered into a new partnership with Athletic Sports Group and its subsidiary Fight Globe.
All right, Fight Globe.
To accelerate its global expansion and growth. It's a multi-year deal. The two parties will work on focusing on getting premium international partnerships for the United States and Canada.
Okay.
And also PFL, the Professional Fighters League. They're going to be doing a lot more live events. Now, you remember PFL. They were doing the stuff over at the events over at Ocean Casino.
Yeah, no, I was going to say Professional Fighters League. They're the ones that were in Atlantic City.
That's them. So, they have the deal with DraftKings.
So, great.
They have a deal with DraftKings for fantasy and sports betting whenever they get sports betting in certain states, you know, for PFL.
You know, that's what, you know, growing up in New Jersey, I was a little young to get to all the professional boxing in Atlantic City when it was so big and things like that. And now it's coming back with boxing and also the Professional Fighters League and things like that. So it's really starting to build up. So I'm excited because I feel like, you know, fighting's back in Atlantic City and now I can go watch it. That's something I missed growing up when I was too young.
Well, I always thought the PFL was kind of interesting because it's not just, you know, having boxing matches or MMA matches consistently like UFC does.
Yep.
They actually have a regular season, playoffs, and a world championship bout.
Okay.
So they run it like a league.
Oh, well, okay.
You know, like a sports league, like NFL. They have playoffs, they have championship games, and they have a prize purse for everyone, every step of the way. They also do original programming. They do archive content. You know, basically their website is anything and everything MMA.
Great.
They actually said they, according to their numbers, and this is their report, the league saw an 87% growth in average audience over the last year.
Well, people are like me. I mean, people who are boxing fans or people who are MMA fans are excited that it's back in Atlantic City. Everyone I've talked to in New Jersey and Pennsylvania say, hey, you know, this is great that MMA is in Atlantic City, or and also boxing is in Atlantic City, and it's a great, great event to go to.
Well, this is going to be an interesting combination of parties here because Fight Globe. I'll be honest with you. I was not familiar with who Fight Globe was. Fight Globe covers 750 live combat events and ancillary content and has access to 150 markets all over the world.
Wow, great.
So that's an incredible, incredible reach for not only Fight Globe, but now for Professional Fighters League. They've been looking to expand. They've been looking to make a better product or at least a more accessible product around the country, and also now they're talking about Canada. According to PFL, again, their numbers, they reach 1 billion households globally.
Wow, great.
Their website, their fights. So they're going to be looking at doing some of their events all across the United States, Canada. They're doubling the amount of the events. They're also, you know, keeping tabs on what's going on with sports betting. I think Canada is the thing they're watching because of what just happened with Canada passing single event sports betting.
Sure, sure.
They have the smart cage technology too. I remember that when they announced it. That was actually a very interesting addition to the MMA scene, where they actually have data points being generated in the fight. So it's going to be kind of interesting.
It's all about the data. It's all about the data.
I'm wondering if they're going to be able to get approved for event wagering in Canada pretty quickly.
We'll see. Who knows? I mean, I get, you have to apply to all these
different provinces.
I guess the different provinces. I guess you have to go through the certification through the different provinces and things like that. It's just like U.S.
Yeah.
The states have their own things that they allow betting on. And so I guess Canada's like that, too.
Exit 4.
And last but not least, election time is upon us.
Yes.
And that means polls. Polls, 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 basically. We have a new poll to talk about on sports betting released by Stockton University.
Which is in near Atlantic City in New Jersey.
The main question in this poll, which, by the way, sampled 552 voters and conducted between September 17th and 25th, error margin of 4.1% plus or minus.
Okay.
Have to throw those stats out.
Sure.
Sample size, 552 people voting. Main question in the poll was whether the residents approve of a constitutional amendment to allow wagering at casinos and old or new racetracks on various college athletic events and sports. Kind of a broad question there.
Well, the one thing in New Jersey you have to realize that we are not allowed to place a bet on a college and university located within New Jersey, and we cannot bet on an activity or collegiate event that occurs within the state borders in New Jersey. So this is one of those things where this will allow betting on New Jersey colleges by people in New Jersey and collegiate events in New Jersey.
Well, let's set the stage here for the results. 2 months ago, another poll done by Fairleigh Dickinson, 25% of New Jersey voters were in favor of this idea.
Okay.
Only 25%. Residents opposing an amendment was 45%.
Hmm. Interesting.
I'm sorry, it was 49%.
All right.
This time, this poll released by Stockton, the 49% dropped to 45.
Okay.
That are against the constitutional amendment.
Okay.
So still is kind of a majority people. And the 25% went up to 40.
Okay.
That's a huge jump.
Yeah, that is a big jump.
So it's kind of interesting to see people are still not in favor of college sports betting.
It's strange. I don't know. There are other states that have, you know, you can bet on the teams in their state, but you can't place prop bets on the collegiate students participating in that college game. So I wouldn't mind that. I mean, it's something. It was very strange last year when there was actual a I can't remember the actual name of the collegiate tournament. It's a basketball tournament. I think it was the MAC tournament.
It was
held in Convention Center in Atlantic City with 9 sports books around it, and no one can bet on it because it was a collegiate event taking place in New Jersey. So it was forbidden for New Jersey people to bet on it.
Well, I have to admit,
and it was held in Atlantic City.
I'm looking at some of these polls that are coming out, and they're doing general questions. I understand they have to generalize it for the mass population out there in the state. But maybe a more specific poll should be sent out and find out exactly if there's a difference between people's perceptions of betting on the sport, like a game itself, versus the player prop situation.
Yeah.
I bet you if you think about it, the way some of these polls are worded, you're not getting that breakdown where people need to see, you know, maybe they do understand the difference betting on the athlete versus betting on the team.
Well, truth be told, I got my absentee ballot, and I already voted yes for the constitutional.
Oh, I did too. Okay. I did too. So, but again,
so if you want my opinion on it, I said yes.
But like I said, I'm just wondering if a more pinpoint poll needs to be done. I don't mean just statewide, but maybe nationwide, because you know a lot of people, you know, may have an aversion to betting on college sports in general, but when you break it down, maybe they don't care much about the team versus the actual player, because the player is more important to some people.
Just to be clear, in New Jersey, you can bet on college sports. You just can't bet on the teams that are located in New Jersey.
Or any events.
Or any events.
Played.
So we have college sports betting. We just don't have sports betting on events or teams located in the state of New Jersey.
So, I just think a more pinpoint poll may need to be done to see if there is a dichotomy between those two.
And today's trip down the turnpike was brought to you by Drizzly, your online liquor store. Available in over 95 cities across North America, Drizzly offers a huge selection and competitive pricing with a side of personalized content. Now there's no need to leave the house. Get alcohol delivered in less than an hour by Drizzly. Head on over to drizzly.com and order today. And now get $5 off your first order of $20 or more when using our promo code DRINK19 at checkout. Shop beer, wine, and liquor with drizzly.com.
And as always, you can get in touch with Turnpike Sports by calling or texting us at 609-512-5910. That's 609-512-5910. At Turnpike Sports is the show's handle on Facebook and Twitter. At Turnpike Sports Radio is our handle on Instagram. And as always, our email address is info@turnpikesportsradio.com. And don't forget, you can listen to the show via Spotify, Amazon Music, iTunes, Radio.com mobile app, as well as Stitcher and YouTube. You can also watch us on your smart TV, Roku, Amazon Fire, Apple TV. Head on over to turnpikesports.net. You'll be able to watch our video channel there.
Well, we got a big show coming up for you. We have a Beatin the House segment. We have our Week 5 NFL picks, and we have a book report. But right after this, I'm going to be talking with Mike Seeley from Better Collective. We're going to talk all about the news coming out of the horse racing scene. And also, we're going to talk a little bit about fantasy weather. So stick around. More Turnpike Sports right after this.
Auto Accident Help Desk is a marketing agency connecting callers with attorneys. Providers pay a fee for advertising services.
I love getting my kids ready and driving them to school.
But a careless driver can change your life in an instant. And insurance companies want to settle on the cheap. Auto Accident Help Desk connects victims with powerful lawyers. They fight for you.
I called Auto Accident Help Desk and got help for my pain and suffering.
Don't let an insurance company take advantage of you. Our attorneys fight and beat big insurance every day.
Call 800-297-9766. 800-297-9766.
If you've been injured in an automobile accident in the last 6 months, you owe it to yourself to make this free call with no obligation. We're available 24/7 to help you get the money you deserve for your pain and suffering. Auto Accident Help Desk helps accident victims like you every day.
Call 800-297-9766. 800-297-9766. 800-297-9766.
Is your bathroom looking old and worn out? Want to update it, but you don't know where to start? Then let VCI Bath & Shower show you how to turn that old bath into an aisle of beauty and functionality. Our residential bathroom solutions provide the best value on the market, and our customer service is second to none. Our cost-effective VCI Bath & Shower family of products has what you need.
Remodeling our bathroom was a big decision for us.
They didn't make a mess out of our house at all. And at the end of the day, we had a beautiful new bathroom. And it was a great experience the whole way through.
We have the best monthly payment programs in the industry, with payments as low as $68 per month or no interest, no payments for 18 months. That's right. Get the bathroom of your dreams now and pay for it in 2021. Call 1-800-308-8291 for a free, no-obligation price quote. That's 1-800-308-8291. When you want quality bathroom products at a great price, it's got to be BCI Bath & Shower. That's 1-800-308-8291.
Welcome back to Turnpike Sports. I am Dave Weishaddle. And I always love it when the writers from USBets.com and Better Collective come on, because they always have the latest information about what's going on in the gambling world, and our next guest is no exception. Mike Seely has also written articles for the New York Times and LA Times, as well as the Daily Racing Form, which has been in the news a lot lately. On the line, for the first time on the show, by the way, is Mike Seely. Mike, thanks for coming on.
Of course, Dave. My pleasure.
I know, as I said, you wrote articles for New York Times and LA Times, but there's one place I want to ask you about that you contributed to in the past, and that is the Daily Racing Form. Apparently, they're not only focusing on horse racing anymore, they're getting into the sports betting business. I mean, for an organization that always said they're dedicated to be the data provider for a single sport, which is horse racing, what led them to make a try at the sports betting business?
I don't think it's that unusual, to be honest. I mean, look at Maxim is now, yeah, now has a sports book. And we know Maxim for things very different than sports. So I just think it's another example of, you know, kind of an August publication, which I love and used to contribute to, trying to stay afloat, trying to get in on the action. And, you know, they know the action. They know horse racing. And it's not easy to get into the horse betting business. So if you're already in there and can get into the sports betting business, it kind of makes sense.
You know, for me, there's always been a connection between sports betting and horse racing. I mean, I'm sitting here in New Jersey, and the reason why New Jersey wanted sports betting was to help the horse racing industry in the state. I'm curious, around the country, do people feel that there is a connection between horse racing and sports betting?
I mean, yes and no. I mean, on the one hand, horse racing, horse betting very much is sports betting.
Yeah.
It's kind of the original sports betting to me. On the other hand, I think if you look at demographics, as I outlined in my piece, the average horse bettor is very different than the average sports bettor, just in terms of their median age. I mean, I'm under 50, barely, but the average sports bettor, or the average horse bettor, is over 50, whereas the average sports bettor is under. So I think the challenge, you know, for FanDuel, for the DRF, for any company that's involved in both, is going to be to bridge that gap. How do you do it? So that'll be what's going to be interesting over the next couple of years, to see how they go about that.
Yeah, no, that's the first thing I thought of. You know, over the past couple of months, there have been a ton of surveys analyzing sports betting demographics, and they point out what you just pointed out. You know, the sports bettor is under 50, the horse bettor is over 50. I'm just curious, does Daily Racing Form have some kind of plan to bridge that gap, or is it going to be as they go along, we're going to see how many younger audience members we pick up?
I assume that, yes, they have a plan. You know, I mean, there's so many mergers going on in this world, as you know, and it was only about a year ago that the DRF and its, you know, kind of sister properties were on the shopping block, and, you know, the FanDuels, the DraftKings, a lot of the more mainstream sports books nowadays were rumored to be interested in them. So who knows if this might be a play at kind of rejuvenating those talks, or if they're going to go it alone. I mean, nothing surprises me anymore in this industry.
You know, I was very interested in one of the points you brought up in your article on usbets.com. I mean, everyone has heard of the daily racing form. I mean, name recognition is great in this industry. It's great in the business. But I'm wondering if in some weird way their name recognition could actually work against them. I mean, when I hear daily racing form, I don't think of sports betting. I mean, how big of a challenge will that be to say, hey, we're daily racing form, but you know what? We're not just horse racing anymore.
Yeah, no, that's a very good point. And I could, again, go back to Maxim Bet to make the point that it doesn't matter. But no, I don't know. I mean, that's a great point. I mean, you think of the DRF, you think of horse racing. But I do think, and I'm sort of a homer here because I used to write for them, it's such a great brand. It's such a trusted brand. I mean, you can not bet on horses and know that brand. And I think that outweighs any, you know, negative connotation, or not negative, but, you know, any association with strictly horse racing. I think the DRF's just brand trust would outweigh that in the end. That's my opinion.
You know, you mentioned it about the deals that daily racing form could make. How important are those deals in getting a foothold in the market? I mean, when I think of FanDuel, I also think of TVG, which is a big horse racing industry media outlet. I mean, is that what daily racing form should be looking at doing?
Yeah, I don't know about that, but if I'm looking at it from like a DraftKings standpoint, or, you know, any sports book, any online sports book, the level for entry into the horse racing realm to be able to offer bets there, it takes a little bit more than other sports. I mean, you have to negotiate simulcast rides, you have to negotiate with horsemen, and, you know, with DRF bets, you know, ADW product, they already have those things negotiated. So if I'm a sports book that doesn't have a foothold in horse racing and I want to get one, rather than going out and starting from scratch, which is really tough to do, I don't know, I'd certainly be looking at something like a DRF partnership or acquisition.
I got to tell you, that's a great point, because when I was thinking of daily racing form getting into the sports betting realm, I wasn't thinking of the other side, you know, a sports book wanting to get into the horse racing realm. And I was wondering, how attractive is that? Because as you said, getting into the horse racing arena is much more difficult than starting a sports book.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, I think it will get more attractive when, not if, fixed odds wagering becomes more prevalent in the U.S. I mean, if you're going in cold and you've never been in a horse race, a parimutuel pool is a pretty difficult thing to understand. Mm-hmm. Fixed odds, not so much. So I personally kind of like parimutuel pools. I think they're kind of fun. It's like peer-to-peer to peer to a million peer betting. But I think in order for horse racing to gain a broader, younger audience of bettors, they're going to have to go fixed odds. And I think once that happens, that'll be a way more attractive sport for newer bettors to bet on.
What have you heard that when DRF eventually gets into the sports betting arena, what will the platform look like? I mean, when we log on to betting on the daily racing form site, what can we expect to see there?
You know, I don't know that for certain. I think that the one precedent for what they might do is with Twin Spires, Churchill Downs product. You know, that's the one other, you know, with the exception of FanDuel, that's kind of the one other player that's in both horse racing and sports betting. And, you know, Twin Spires does a ton of business with ADW. They haven't done a ton of business with sports betting yet. If you look at the numbers in Indiana, which neighbors Kentucky, obviously, They're starting to do, a little bit better. My colleague Chris Altruda covers that beat, and he's kind of chronicled their slow but significant rise in Indiana. So I don't know. I mean, if I were the DRF, I'd look at what Twin Spires has done. I personally happen to think DRF has better brand recognition and respect than Twin Spires, because there's some people in the horse racing industry who aren't thrilled with what Churchill has done with Arlington and other properties. So we'll see what happens there.
You know, I live relatively close to Atlantic City, and when I go there, I always go to the Borgata, because not only do they have a great sports book, right across the hall from that, they have Atlantic City's only race book. So when I heard DRF was doing something like getting into the sports betting realm, I thought it was, oh my God, this is going to be one-stop shopping for me. Am I expecting too much from daily racing form? Will there be sports betting and horse betting all in one site?
I sure hope so, man. That was the first place my mind went
to.
was that there would be these DRF branded physical sports books at horse tracks all over the country where you can do it all. So we're on the same page. I don't know if we're in the minority, probably, mm-hmm. Because we're horse and sports betting guys. But man, that's exactly where my mind went when I first heard of that.
Let me ask you about timing here. I mean, here in New Jersey, there are 21 online sports books. In Colorado, there's something like 26 online books. In Pennsylvania, there's 13 books. I mean, how challenging will it be for daily racing form to break through in markets like those? Because, maybe some people are saying, well, you're a little late to the business here.
That's definitely a credible take for sure. But I think that, they've had their DRF Bets product out there. They've got their great name recognition. So they've got people in their database that they can try to turn into sports bettors. It's all there for them. They don't have to build that from scratch. But a lot of it still is about promos. If they can offer some killer promos, they can get a foothold, man. I'll dance around, horse racing, sports betting sites based on how fat a promo I'm getting. And that's everyone. So that's not going to be around forever, but it sure is around right now and will be for a while.
Now, as I said before, the reason why New Jersey said they wanted sports betting was to help the horse racing industry. I mean, here in New Jersey, two of the best retail sports books are located at racetracks. You have the FanDuel Sportsbook at the Meadowlands and Caesars Sportsbook at Monmouth Park. I mean, recently you wrote an article in Hoosier States Bets about how other racetracks are faring when they added a sports book to their property. What did you find in the area of the country, especially in the Midwest, on how sports books are affecting racetracks?
Well, very positively. The one racetrack I wrote about, which used to be called Fairmont Park, and now, if my memory serves me, it's sort of an unwieldy name, is FanDuel Sportsbook and Horse Racing is actually the name of the track.
Okay.
I think people still call it Fairmont Park out there.
Yeah.
But that track has been left for dead for the last quarter century. And now that the fact that it's probably going to outlast Arlington Park is unfathomable. And the reason for that is the FanDuel partnership. In states where you need a physical tether to operate mobile sports books, it's going to be an absolute lifesaver for some of these tracks that are just hanging on by a thread. And make no mistake about it, I love Fairmont Park / FanDuel Park, mm-hmm. but it's the second dumpiest track in the country after Arapahoe Park in suburban Denver. So that says something.
Well, let me ask you something. Going forward, will that be the blueprint for racetracks now? I mean, hey, if we're having a little problem, let's invite a sports book in.
I sure hope so. I mean, that industry's been looking for a way to keep its lower rung properties afloat for a while, and I think they've found it. I sure hope that's the blueprint. I mean, we could have a whole nother discussion about the sort of the breeding shortages in horse racing and the amount of yearlings, how that's been halved in the last 15 years. But I think if you've got some certainty that these tracks are indeed going to stick around, it might buoy that as well.
You know, one of the things right now that is being used to help the horse racing industry further is the implementation of fixed odds wagering as opposed to parimutuel betting. I mean, for people who don't know, fixed odds wagering is when you place a bet on a horse, you lock in the odds at that time you make the bet, and you don't have to wait until the start of the race to find out what the final odds will be. I've had guests on this show saying we would have never gotten that past if we didn't have sports betting where people are used to betting like that. They're used to betting fixed odds. How important do you think fixed odds betting will be for the future of the horse racing industry?
I think it's very important. I mean, if you're going to attract new bettors, you have to meet them at their level. And, you know, sports bettors, people who just gamble casually on sports are totally accustomed to fixed odds. Almost every other sport has fixed odds. Mm-hmm. And for them to say, oh, I thought I got this horse at 4-1, now it's down to 2-1, that's just a foreign substance to them, you know? it's a difficult thing to explain. Now, I mean, if you're really into horse betting, I kind of like the parimutuel stuff. Mm-hmm. I kind of like seeing a horse that had its morning line at 8-1 go to 15-1 in the Derby, and then I'm going to bet on it. But that's a big education process. And I think, you know, there's a huge advantage to offering both fixed odds and parimutuel, which is where this thing is going to go anyway.
Now, I know New Jersey went through years of trying to push this through and it's finally signed into law. I mean, do you think once a couple of states implement fixed odds wagering that it will sweep across the country like sports betting did over the last couple of years?
It won't be as swift, but I would not be surprised if 2 years from now there's a dozen states where fixed odds on horse racing is legal, and that's based on kind of my own reporting and just where things are going to go. It's not going to be just the absolute Wild West that general sports betting is, but it'll be like, you know, a half-measure version of it.
I want to leave horse racing right now, and I want to ask you about an article you did for usbets.com that just absolutely blew my mind. In it, you talked about the very real possibility that very soon we can actually have fantasy weather. I mean, I never thought of weather as a fantasy sport or something I can win money on, but it actually looks like it may happen. So what is going on with the possibility of fantasy weather?
Well, it's sort of happening, or it tried to happen. There was an Oklahoma-based outfit that tried to get it off the ground a couple years ago and then shelved their experiment, but they're coming back soon, probably next year. The whole thing started as a joke, Dave, as I wrote my article. The night I met my wife, we started talking about how now there's fantasy NASCAR, fantasy golf, and this is back in 2003. When fantasy sports were still kind of just the big sports, right? And I joked like, hey, you know, one day there'll probably be fantasy weather. And then we started talking about how that would look, and we were laughing, drinking. And here it is. It's a real thing now. DraftKings has their, you know, wild weather Wednesday, mm-hmm. Free to play. You got like, what, a dozen cities where you bet the over-under on the temperature, which is hilarious, but I think it's going to, I think you're going to get real action on it, especially with global warming.
I got to tell you, I love that concept. On this show, we have a lot of professional sports bettors who come on who actually use weather reports as part of the research they use to bet on the sports that are occurring in the weather.
It's huge.
I mean, it's huge. They depend on the weather. I mean, I never thought of actually betting on the weather itself. Now, you mentioned one of the ways they bet on the weather, I guess the temperature. Is there other ways you can bet on the weather, or are there other what is this Oklahoma-based company, what are they planning on doing?
Well, I think they're pretty temperature-based, but in mm-hmm. talking to them, I mean – you know, I think you could have the amount of rainfall, the amount of snowfall, wind speed, you name it, man. I mean, the weather's getting weirder, and the weirder the weather gets, the more intrigue there will be in betting on it.
You know, it like I said, it blows my mind. It's an amazing article you wrote. It's on usbets.com. But, you know, we have just a little bit of time left, and I speaking as an Eagles fan, I want to hit on a article you wrote in Penn Bets. Now, I'm from New Jersey. I'm an Eagles fan, but I also have an office in Boston. So this article really touched my heart. It's about let you explain it. It's about a great tattoo.
So I'll try and boil this down as best I can. I was sitting on a couch, drinking beer, watching football a couple weeks ago, watching the Seahawks, because I live in Seattle. And a friend of mine just started talking about a former coworker who was born in Boston, Patriots fan, mm-hmm. made a bet on the Super Bowl with an Eagles fan who lives, ironically, in Spokane, Washington. Never been to Philly, I don't think. He just like Randall Cunningham when he was a kid.
Okay, yeah.
And they made this bet, the loser of that Super Bowl, the 2018 Super Bowl, I believe it was, had to get the opposing team's quarterback tattooed on them somewhere. And, of course, the Patriots lost that Super Bowl. So the Patriots fan was on the hook for a Nick Foles tattoo somewhere on his body. And for months he put this off, and then his buddy actually made an appointment for him at a tattoo parlor and said, "Hey, you're coming." You know, and the Patriots fan had run this by his wife, who said, "No effing way are you getting a Nick Foles tattoo on your body." And then so they go to Spokane, the two of them. They get a hotel room, nice hotel. The girls go to a winery. The boys go to the tattoo parlor. He gets tattooed after offering his buddy $5,000 to not have to go through with it. His buddy declined that offer. And then the Patriots fan was told by the Eagles fan, "Well, I'll do $6,000 on a 6-month payment plan." And that insulted the Patriots fan to the point where he went ahead and got the tattoo. So he's down in the hotel bar afterwards, and his wife said, "Hey, I'm in the hot tub. Come up here and join me." So he goes up there, and his wife's like, "Are you going to get in the hot tub?" He's like, "No. Nah, I'm good." And, you know, understandably, she was, you know, kind of chagrined by that comment. And then he came clean. He dropped his boxer, showed her the Foles tattoo, and she didn't talk to him for 3 weeks. And at the time, she was just his fiance. Amazingly, they wound up actually going through at the wedding. And the Eagles fan and the Patriots fan are better friends to this day because they were so impressed with each other's loyalty to the integrity of the bet. Just a great story. They both live in Spokane now. They're good friends. The wife still hates the tattoo.
I also love the fact that that tattoo is huge. I mean, it's it's Nick Foles holding up the Lombardi Trophy. It's hilarious, and it's such a great
the guy's thigh.
It's absolutely amazing. I think that Super Bowl spawned so many tattoos, but all the tattoos were of the diagram of the Philly special. So, but this one was absolutely amazing, though. Mike, we're running out of time, but I want to give you the chance to tell everyone where they can read your articles. And if you have a social media account, can you give that out, too, so people can follow to what you're up to?
Sure. Social media is on Twitter at MDSealy. And then I write for U.S. Bets. I write for Sports Handle. I write for Penn Bets. I write for Tennessee Bets, the whole Better Collective Network. Some great content can be found on all those sites. Great writers. Everything you want to know about betting is there, sports betting.
Mike Sealy from Better Collective, thank you so much for coming on and giving us an update about what's going on in the gambling world. You gave some great information. I hope you come back on real soon to give us another update. Thanks so much for your time.
Anytime, Dave. Thank you.
Stick around. More Turnpike Sports right after this.
Free stuff is awesome, but free stuff that will spice up your bedroom is even better. Just go to adamandeve.com and select almost any one item for 50% off, and then we'll load on the free stuff. Just enter this very exclusive code, BABE16, at checkout, and you'll get 10 tantalizing free gifts, including a sexy item for him, a special toy for her,
ooh,
and a third item you'll both enjoy.
Ooh.
And
6 extra special bonus items that are sure to rev your engine, pique your curiosity, and even blow you away. Plus,
free shipping!
Always sent in discreet packaging. Go to adamandeve.com now. Get 50% off plus the 10 free gifts when you enter the exclusive offer code BABE16. That's BABE16, because without it, no free stuff. That's BABE16 at adamandeve.com.
During these difficult times, we understand how important it is to stay healthy and safe. With so many of us confined to our homes and not being able to work, we feel the financial burden more than ever. Many folks lost their jobs and businesses. Others were furloughed, and some are working from home at reduced pay. Keeping up with your bills is not easy under these circumstances. If you have credit card debt and cannot keep up with your monthly payments, we at Debt Fix Pros are here to help. Give us a call to see how we can reduce your interest rates and lower your monthly payments. Protect your credit and let us help you find a solution that fits your needs. We, your friends at Debt Fix Pros, are here to help. Let us take care of your credit card debt so you can focus on what is really important. Call for a free phone consultation at 800-919-6011. 800-919-6011. That's 800-919-6011. 800-919-6011. United we stand.
With some of the best promotions and offers in the sports betting market, PointsBet simply stands out. PointsBet is the only U.S. online bookmaker to offer points betting, where every yard, every point, every goal, even every play matters. Same-game parlays, good karma payouts, early payouts, and exclusive game day promotions and guarantees for all sports. PointsBet offers more bet types than any other bookmaker in the world, offering a unique set of markets that aren't available anywhere else. And now PointsBet is offering one of the best sign-up offers in the sports betting market today. New customers signing up with code BET21 receive two risk-free bets up to $2,000. Get up to $500 back if your first fixed odds bet loses, and up to $1,500 if your first points betting bet loses. That's code BET21 for two risk-free bets up to $2,000 at PointsBet. PointsBet, it pays to be fast. Must be 21 years or older and in New Jersey to place a bet. Terms and conditions apply. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-GAMBLER.
No, people gotta win sometime.
Now, if you'll excuse me, I have a giant, colorful check to deposit.
Beatin' the House is brought to you by BetMGM Casino. Play your favorite casino games at BetMGM Online Casino. Slots, table games, live dealer games, everything you love about Atlantic City and Vegas, all online at BetMGM. Don't wait. Join in the fun now. Go to BetMGM Casino, create an account using our promo code Turnpike, and become a verified player. New players get $25 free when signing up, plus a first deposit bonus up to $1,000. That's promo code Turnpike at BetMGM.com for a 100% deposit match up to $1,000 plus $25 free. Grab a lion's share of the fun at BetMGM.com. Must be 21 years or older to place a bet. Terms and conditions apply. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-GAMBLER.
And welcome to this week's edition of Beatin the House, where we celebrate the casino wins, the slot machine wins, the keno wins, the lottery wins, the sports betting wins, whatever kind of win you have in the gambling instance and you have beaten the house, we will talk about it in this segment.
Yep.
We're going to go to our home state of New Jersey.
Okay.
I think this is our first New Jersey jackpot.
Really? All right, I'm surprised at that.
Brick and mortar.
Okay, he's a brick and mortar.
Resorts Casino in Atlantic City.
So if it's brick and mortar, if I go to their Facebook, will I see someone with a huge check?
I did not see it on their Facebook.
Okay.
It was in a press release.
Okay, it was in a press release?
Yes.
Okay.
According to the press release issued by Resorts Casino Hotel in Atlantic City, a guest named Donna from Hazlitt, New Jersey, so a local, was very fortunate. According to the release, Donna hit the citywide shared Wheel of Fortune progressive jackpot.
Wow, great.
Again, the IGT Wheel of Fortune games.
That gives out a lot of money, Wheel of Fortune.
This one was the citywide progressive.
Okay.
Which means these were all tied into the machines all across Atlantic City.
Okay.
The jackpot was $1.644 million.
Okay.
No word on what she bet.
Congratulations, Donna.
I'd like to know what she bet for that.
I don't know.
I mean, some of these things don't put the bet amount.
Whatever she bet, yep. It was worth it.
Donna of Hazlitt, New Jersey, is one of the biggest jackpot winners in Atlantic City during the last 10 years.
Wow. Congratulations.
As a matter of fact, I remember, I think I mentioned in a previous edition of Beatin' the House, that I looked back and there weren't too many huge jackpots being given out in Atlantic City. I think there was like $2 million jackpots over the last year.
Okay.
And so, but none were $1.6 million. I mean, they had just hit $1 million kind of thing. They weren't that. They weren't this size. This was the biggest.
Wow.
Which was really cool to see.
That was great. Great.
Going back over to Vegas, the Orleans Casino. We've had the Orleans on a couple times.
Yeah, yeah.
A lucky slot player turned a $3.75 bet into more than $665,000.
Wow, great.
The gambler, going by the name Bruce, was visiting Las Vegas from San Diego and hit on the Aristocrats Gaming Buffalo Grand.
Now, that's the one with the picture of the big buffalo on it, right?
Yes.
That's the one I always see walking into a casino. That's like the first thing I see.
That's the
one. Because they have these big cabinets.
That's exactly it. They had those bank of cabinets right at the beginning of the casino
floor. Right, yeah.
As a matter of fact, I think when they actually get them installed in the casino, they find out the entrance that has the most traffic.
Sure,
and
sure.
They put them right near there. So, but this one was the Buffalo Grand, because there's I think there's about six or seven different Buffalo-branded games that Aristocrat puts out. And some of them are all linked together.
It's very popular.
But he was at the Buffalo. He was at the Orleans Casino, owned by Boyd Gaming. Casino representatives say he was in town with family and won the grand jackpot on the $3.75 wager. And this is the second major jackpot issued by the Buffalo Grand machines. Earlier this month, another Buffalo Grand jackpot was hit at the Cannery Casino for $1 million.
Wow. Boy.
So Buffalo Grand is the progressive to play.
You know, I see some Buffalo stuff online in New Jersey, the online slots in New Jersey.
They're all tied in.
I don't know
if the online ones are all tied into each other, but I know the land ones. If you're in a casino.
See, hearing these stories, now I want to go play what was the first one? That was the Wheel of Fortune. Now I want to check out the Buffalo Grand thing. So,
you got to remember.
It gets me motivated.
The Wheel of Fortune game, which is 25 years old.
Sure.
They actually have the most variations of the game out there. I don't know which variation she was playing.
There's a ton of them.
There's over 50 variations of the Wheel of Fortune game, and there's also multiple variations of the Wheel of Fortune slot online too. So you may be playing Wheel of Fortune, but you may not be playing the Wheel of Fortune that this woman was playing over in resorts. Same thing with Buffalo. Buffalo has all these different iterations online as well in the online casinos. Let's go on to, we're going to New Buffalo, Michigan, staying with the Buffalo theme.
New Buffalo, Michigan, that's the name of the town.
That's the name of the town.
Okay.
The Four Winds Casino in New Buffalo, Michigan. That's just north of the Indiana-Michigan state line, by the way.
All right.
I had to go look that up myself. A Northwest Indiana resident won playing the Dollar Storm Caribbean Gold slot machine. Never heard of that one.
Nope, never heard of that one. What's it called again?
The Dollar Storm Caribbean Gold.
Okay.
At the Four Winds Casino.
All right.
The winner, identified by the casino only as a resident of the Jasper County town of Wheatfield, so anonymous from Wheatfield, hit the machine's super grand progressive jackpot worth $220,980.
Wow.
Records show he played a $50 wager.
Wow.
On the spin.
I've never done $50 on one spin of a slot machine. Have you?
No, I've never done that. I barely do the...
Good for... Hey, you know what? That was a gutsy move.
The minimum bet on the machine was $5, so he's playing 50
that's
per
a
spin.
Gutsy move. Good for him.
And casino officials...
We said a resident. We were just... Is it a him or a her? They don't... Are they saying he...
According to the report, it was a him.
Okay. Well, congratulations to him.
So, but the casino officials have said now the progressive jackpot has been reset and will resume building until another player wins the top prize. Do they really need to put that in the release? Because it's a progressive jackpot. Don't people realize it resets? I mean, I don't mean to be
maybe a snarky comment, but maybe not.
I don't know if you need to put that in the release.
But, I mean, does it just click down to zero again?
No, they have a certain minimum
level.
That's
what I mean. Well, that's a good question. I mean, it's a, who knows what it starts with?
Maybe they should have said
It'd be just my luck to win a progressive jackpot right after someone else wins it.
Yeah, you're
right?
The next spin.
Right. Yeah. Hey, look, you won $20.
Yeah. Let's stay. Let's go back over to Vegas, Red Rock Resort. Another Stations Casino, by the way. Stations Casino seems to pay out all everywhere on every single one of their casinos.
I stayed at a Stations Casino. It's a fun place to stay in. So, you know.
Local video poker player hit a Royal Flush progressive jackpot at Red Rock Resort. And he was a Stations Casino boarding pass holder.
Great.
Which
Good.
Is the loyalty club.
Great.
I love the way they call that, the boarding pass. It was actually kind of cool. He turned a $15 bet into a jackpot of $150,853.
Great.
He was playing double-double bonus poker.
I know what that is. I play
it's video
before.
Poker.
Yeah, I played that before.
I see it everywhere.
I play that when I go to the bar. It's the ones
that's
that are
exactly it. Yeah,
in the bar.
But they also have banks of them everywhere on the casino floor too. Yeah. So he wasn't sitting.
Played video poker on the gaming floor. It's always been when I went to the bar, had a beer, and I played video poker.
Well, the press release made that distinction. He was playing on the casino floor.
Okay.
Not at the bar.
All right. Okay.
So. I guess that is a thing people don't realize it's on the floor, too.
Can someone do a study that do you win more video poker on the gaming floor instead of the bar? Or
is it vice versa?
Have there been studies? There's studies all the time in gaming. I wonder if there's a study on that.
I'm sure someone's already actually looked at it. Go to Wizard of Oz. He's probably got
someone probably got a grant for that from the
from UNLV.
Gaming Institute.
Let's leave the casinos for a little bit and talk lottery. We got a couple lottery wins to talk about. Two from the Virginia Lottery.
Two? Wow,
two.
Okay.
Renee Trueheart from Richmond, Virginia, won $114,659 playing the Virginia Lottery's RoboCashed Instant Online Game. She did it at home, by the way,
Good.
Which is the purpose of an online casino.
Great.
She played the online game on her personal device, didn't say whether it was a tablet or a phone, and she just kept playing the game because she saw it was new, and she just kept playing. And then she hit for $114,659.
Certainly paid off.
Yep. It's a progressive jackpot. So it was tied in with, I think, two other games that they have on the Virginia Lottery. Odds of winning any prize in this game are 1 in 4.58. So not bad odds to win.
Good. Yeah, no, it's something good to
so
play.
So she won $114,000.
So that was the Virginia Lottery's RoboCash game, right?
One of their instant online games,
All
yes.
All right.
Here's another instant online winner. Bob Shea wasn't doing much, just sitting in front of the TV playing some Virginia Lottery games on his personal device. That's a line directly from the press release.
Wow. Great.
Suddenly, the Sutherland man saw something he couldn't believe. He had just won $185,000 playing the Cash Buster Multiplier game.
That's great.
That's another online instant game, and the odds in winning prizes on this progressive, again, another progressive, Virginia Lottery has a lot of progressive online games, which is pretty cool.
Great.
1 in 4.64 million. 1 in 4.64, I should say. That's how the odds to winning.
Okay.
Now, we're going over to the Oklahoma Lottery for our last entry for the day, and they are looking for the winner of a $2 million winning ticket.
Wow. Well, hopefully by the time this airs, they found that person.
This was
so. If anyone's listening in Oklahoma or passed through Oklahoma and got a lottery ticket, check it out. You might be a $2 million winner.
I'm assuming by the time this airs, they're going to find this person.
I like the fact that they're looking.
It's the second $2 million Powerball winner drawn in just 10 days. He didn't win the grand prize, but they won the one of the lower level prizes of the overall jackpot, because Powerball still hadn't been won, as we're taping this anyway.
Mm-hmm.
The ticket was sold at the Snack Shack.
Snack Shack!
At 12th and Broadway in Sulphur, Oklahoma.
Sulphur, Oklahoma.
That must be a really smelly town. Smells
very,
like sulfur.
Very interesting name.
Yeah.
Is that why it's named Sulphur? Because
I have no idea. I've never been to Sulphur, Oklahoma.
Sulphur, Oklahoma.
The winner has matched 5 out of 5 white balls and added Power Play, a $1 investment that turned a $1 million prize into the $2 million prize. Let's see. Wednesday night's Powerball winner, the $2 million, is the 72nd Oklahoma Powerball Lottery millionaire, including a Norman woman who won a $2 million Powerball prize on September 20th.
Wow.
So September was a month for Powerball winners in Oklahoma. But that's it for this week's Beatin' the House. And if you have any casino wins, lottery wins, sports betting wins, let us know. info@turnpikesportsradio.com, and we can talk about them on the air.
Our Week 5 NFL picks are next, so stick around. We'll be right back with more Turnpike Sports. The East Coast Gaming Congress returns for its 24th year on October 25th and 26th at Harrah's Waterfront Conference Center in Atlantic City. As the largest gaming conference in the eastern United States, the East Coast Gaming Congress features keynote addresses from top gaming executives, leaders from gaming suppliers, sports betting operators, lotteries, and government agencies. In addition to traditional brick-and-mortar gaming, the East Coast Gaming Congress focuses on cutting-edge issues that range from sports betting to esports to iGaming. And for the third consecutive year, New Jersey Governor Phil Murphy will deliver the State of Gaming keynote address. Over 500 gaming operators, analysts, attorneys, and other gaming-related professionals are expected to attend ECGC. Go to ecgc.us for the full two-day conference schedule and registration. Early bird savings are available, too. The 24th Annual East Coast Gaming Congress and Next Gen Gaming Institute on October 25th and 26th at Harrah's Waterfront Conference Center in Atlantic City. Register today at ecgc.us.
Talcum Powder Hotline is a marketing firm that represents lawyers jointly advertising their services, not attorney spokesperson.
This is an important medical announcement. Talcum powder products from some of the best-known brands have been linked to ovarian cancer. Any woman who has used a talcum powder product and has been diagnosed with ovarian cancer may be entitled to substantial compensation. Studies show that women with long-term use of talcum powder, including baby powder for feminine hygiene, can increase the risk of contracting ovarian cancer. Call now for a free assessment of your case and potential money damages. This call is confidential. There's no cost, and you may be eligible. Juries have awarded millions of dollars to women who should have been warned about the risks of ovarian cancer with long-term use of talcum powder. Call the Talcum Powder Hotline.
Call 800-575-9786. 800-575-9786. 800-575-9786.
More bets, better odds at PlaySugarHouse.com. Sign up today at PlaySugarHouse.com and don't forget to use our promo code PIKE to take advantage of their first deposit match up to $250. Must be 21 years or older and in New Jersey to place a bet. Terms and conditions apply. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-GAMBLER.
This week's Turnpike Sports Pro Pick segment is brought to you by PointsBet Online Sportsbook. Take advantage of their no-juice NFL game lines every week of the NFL season. That's right, PointsBet is giving higher payouts and you get 100% of the profits. PointsBet also offers its customers live streaming and game tracker animations. Get in the game and place live bets even faster. Join PointsBet today and use promo code BET21 and receive two risk-free bets up to $2,000. Again, that's two risk-free bets up to $2,000 when you sign up at PointsBet.com with our code BET21. Stream live, bet live, win fast with PointsBet. Must be at least 21 years or older to place a bet. Terms and conditions apply. New customers only. Problem gambler? Call 1-800-GAMBLER.
Okay, welcome to this week's Pro Pick segment. We're dealing with NFL Week 5. As always, we do three games each. We do, money lines.
Money lines too easy.
Totals and spreads. That's all we do.
I save them for my parlays.
Yes. That's where you should use the money lines. But again, three games each. We choose either totals or spreads, and then we put them up on the blog afterwards. TurnpikeSportsRadio.com. Click on the blog button. Kind of a rough week last week for both of us. We both went 1-2.
Yeah. 1-2. And the one I won, I didn't think I'd win early in the I think I took the over in the Indianapolis game, and I thought they would watching that the first half, they were Colts and the Dolphins were just awful, and they weren't scoring, but I actually hit the over in that one. So that was my one win.
I have to admit, there's been some pretty high-scoring games to start the season off, and some really good games, too. For season to date, I'm still in the lead. I'm 9-3 now.
Good.
After a bad week. You're 4-6-2. You're slowly getting there.
I'm getting there. I'm crawling out.
Like
of
I
hole.
Said at the beginning of this season, you always come in at the end to win the season. I always have the early lead. So
I'm treading water now.
Yes, you're pacing yourself.
Yep.
All right. You went first last week. I'll start this week. My first game is the Green Bay Packers favored by 3 at the Cincinnati Bengals. There's an over-under of 49.5. I think this could be one of the most entertaining games of the weekend. You got Aaron Rodgers, and depending on who you ask, he might be the best quarterback in the NFL, although he's had some clunker games this season, against Joe Burrow, who constantly seems to be doing well, and it's just a matter of the rest of the team functioning, you know, the defenses. Both defenses are kind of spotty at best, and this is why I'm thinking you're going to see a lot of offense in this game. Green Bay put up 27 on the Steelers' defense, who have, I think, have a much better defense than Cincinnati, and the Bengals put up 24 on the Jaguars. So, like I said, both teams, their defenses have had have ups and downs this season. The over 6-1 in the Bengals' last 7 home games versus a team with a winning road record. And the over is 6-0 in the Packers' last 6 versus a team with a winning record. Both these teams have winning records. So, obviously, you're going to see me going with the over 49.5.
All right. My first game is the Thursday night game. I'm taking the Los Angeles Rams, who are favored by 2, versus the Seattle Seahawks with an over-under 54.5 points. The Rams were pushed around by Arizona Cardinals last week, but I think they're going to regroup against a very inconsistent Seahawks. I mean, they're up one week, they're down another week. You just don't know what you're going to get. But the Rams have won 6 of their last meetings with the Seahawks and are a much more talented team. I think the Rams are 10-4-1 against the spread when playing the NFC West. And they certainly have something to prove against last week's loss. So I'm taking the Los Angeles Rams and laying the points.
Okay, my next game is the Buffalo Bills at the Kansas City Chiefs with the Chiefs favored by 2.5, and there's an over-under of 56.5. I went a little against the grain with my normal picks here because I usually stay away from the night games, the Thursday night, Sunday night, Monday nights. I actually did the Sunday and Monday night game, by the way. These two teams score, the Bills and the Chiefs. They score and they score and they score some more. I don't mean to sound Susie in there, but you know, they do score a lot. The over is 5-0 in the Bills' last 5 games as an underdog, which surprisingly they are here. I would have thought the Bills would have been favored, quite honestly. The Bills also shut out the Texans last week. What was it, 40-0?
Well, that's not hard to do.
No. Well, again, the Texans have always scored. They haven't been shut out this season until this last game, which was kind of impressive on the Texans' front because that team's a mess. I don't think that's going to happen here with the Chiefs. The Chiefs put up 42 against the Eagles, but they also gave up 30 against the Eagles. And I think the Eagles have nowhere near the offense Buffalo does. I think you're going to be seeing the two offenses go up and down the field. Buffalo's put up at least 35 points in their last 3 games, and the Chiefs have put up at least 30 in their last 3 or 4. I'm expecting just a fun offensive game here. I'm going over 56.5.
I'm taking this game, too, and I'm just going with the points. I'm going with the Buffalo Bills. The Chiefs do not cover. They're 2-5 against the spread in their last 7 games against a team with a winning record, and the Chiefs' defense is awful. And I think Buffalo is going to put some points on the board. I like Buffalo to cover, but you know what? I wouldn't be surprised if they beat the Chiefs. So I'm taking the underdog Buffalo Bills.
Okay, I'm going now to the Monday night game for my last game.
Oh, okay.
The Indianapolis Colts at the Baltimore Ravens. Ravens are favored by 7 here, and the over-under is 47. Just in case anyone's wondering before we get any further, we are using Tuesday's lines. So these lines may change by game time.
Well, always check the lines before you bet.
But I just wanted to let people know.
Yep.
So, and again, this week's sponsor is PointsBet. We're using their Tuesday lines. Let's see. The Colts managed to score 27 points on a Dolphins defense that I think is actually pretty good. They just lost their middle linebacker, though, the Dolphins moving ahead. So that's going to be so tough sledding. Matter of fact, I think they're one of the double-digit spreads right now against Tampa Bay. Tampa Bay's 10.5, but I think that's going to go more because they just lost their middle linebacker. going off on a tangent there. Sorry. The over is five. The Baltimore put up 23 points against Broncos, which actually has a much better defense than the Dolphins. Mm-hmm. I actually loved watching that game, and I even with that little controversy at the end, you know, with the running play so they can get over 100 yards for the, was it, the 42nd time in a row? I think that's tied to the NFL record.
They might
record.
Break it now. They tied the record.
The over is 5-1 in the Ravens' last six home games, and the over is 4-1 in the Colts' last five games as an underdog. Yeah, like I said, I don't typically do the Monday night games. I'm expecting both offenses, which are getting people back every week and they're getting healthier. I think we're going to see another game where you're going to see about the over 47, I think, is low right now. I think that's going to go higher by the time game time happens. But if you can find a 47, 47.5, I would say do the over 47 right now, which is what I'm doing.
My next game and my last game is the Arizona Cardinals, favored by 5.5 points versus the San Francisco 49ers with an over-under of 50. Look, the Arizona Cardinals are hitting on all cylinders with Kyle Murray, who is the top MVP candidate of the league. 49ers are dealing with some injuries. Jimmy Garoppolo has an injury to his leg, which means you probably might see Trey Lance in a more expanded role in this game. So listen to this. The under for the 49ers in their last eight games against the NFC West is 5-2-1. The under in the last seven games for the Cardinals is 5-2. All the signs are pointing to the under, and this one just the trends and the injuries. So I'm taking the under 50.
Okay, to recap, it was an over festival for me this weekend.
Yeah, boy, you expect a lot of scoring, don't you?
I'd like to see a lot of scoring. Green Bay at Cincinnati, I went with the over 49.5. Bills at Chiefs, I went with the over 56.5. And the Colts Ravens, I went with the over 47.5.
All right, for me, I'm taking the Los Angeles Raiders and laying the 2 points over the Seattle Seahawks. I'm taking the over 50 in the Cardinals-San Francisco game, and I'm taking the underdog Buffalo Bills against the Kansas City Chiefs.
All right, these picks will be up on the Turnpike Sports blog following the publication of the show this week. Head on over to turnpikesportsradio.com, click on the blog button. You can comment on our picks there. You can even suggest your own picks or, you know, whatever. Contact us through Instagram at Turnpike Sports Radio. Twitter is Turnpike Sports, and so is Facebook. And also, don't forget to follow us also on our Turnpike Bets Twitter handle.
The book report is next, so stick around. We'll be right back with more Turnpike Sports.
Attention Medicare recipients and anyone turning 65. Medicare has approved new benefits not included with original Medicare and older Medicare Advantage plans. You may not be getting all of the benefits you're entitled to, including in-home aids, telephone appointments with your doctors, home-delivered meals and prescriptions. These benefits may be available and it's a free call to enroll. The new plans may also offer free eyeglasses, free hearing aids, free wellness visits, and gym memberships. Call the Medicare benefits line now. It's easy. Call 800-217-1797. 800-217-1797. Find out if you're eligible for new benefits like meal and prescription delivery, in-home aids, and telemedicine. Some plans may have a $0 monthly premium or zero copays for big out-of-pocket savings. Not all Medicare Advantage plans are alike. The new plans have more benefits for many people. Call 800-217-1797. 800-217-1797. 800-217-1797.
Having a rough morning after a long night out? Stayed at the party a little too long and you have work the next day? Well, we've all been there. That's why there's Morning Recovery. Morning Recovery is the flagship product of Moore Labs, and it's scientifically engineered to outsmart rough mornings. Their patent-pending formula has been designed to boost your body's natural response to alcohol, rehydrate, and restore your body's vital nutrients. What's that all mean? It means Morning Recovery helps you feel better after drinking. Take one full bottle right before your first drink, between drinks, or up to 1 hour after your last drink. Go get some rest and wake up feeling like $1 million. It's that simple.
And we've got a special offer for you. Use promo code RADIO15 at morelabs.com and get 15% off of your first purchase of Morning Recovery or any of their other great products. That's RADIO15 at morelabs.com to take advantage of this great promo of 15% off of your first purchase. Morning Recovery from More Labs, so you can work hard, play hard, and live life without compromise.
The Turnpike Sports Book Report.
The Turnpike Sports Book Report is brought to you by BorgataSports.com. Your favorite casino is now your favorite sports book, available anywhere in New Jersey, BorgataSports.com. Sign up at BorgataSports.com using our promo code PIKE, that's P-I-K-E. Make your first wager of $20 or more and you'll get $100 in free bets. That's $100 in free bets when your first wager on Borgata Sports is $20 or more. Get into the action with BorgataSports.com. Must be 21 years or older and in New Jersey to place a bet. Terms and conditions apply. Gambling problem? Call 1-800-GAMBLER.
And welcome to another edition of the Turnpike Sports Book Report, where we discuss the news and notes from the sports books and sports betting operators from around the country and Canada as well now, with the launch of single event sports betting in the country north of us. You know, we got a whole bunch of different states reporting their numbers. We've got some legislative stuff to talk about. We've got a bunch of deals.
Now, are these all August numbers? Because I know some of the books like to report late, like Illinois. They're like 2 months behind.
Well, Illinois is one of the few that has not reported their numbers yet. So, right.
But for everyone else, this is August's numbers.
When we talk about the numbers, they'll be August numbers.
August numbers.
Right. But we're going to start off with welcoming the 27th state to legalize sports betting and launch sports betting as
well. Yes, Connecticut.
Welcome to the party.
Right.
I believe it was September 30th, Thursday, September 30th, the state launched its retail sports betting operations. Mohegan Sun in Uncasville, I believe it is.
I don't know which one is. One is in Uncasville.
Foxwoods is in Ledyard.
Okay, that's right. That's right. And really, they're like 10-15 minute drive from each other.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
They're in the same neighborhood.
And I got to admit, I'm very curious to see the I don't mean to play favorites here, but the Foxwoods Resort Sportsbook, they must have taken a little lesson from the Borgata setup, because the sportsbook that they opened, the temporary one, is right next to the Ultimate Racebook in the casino.
Foxwoods has one of the best race books anywhere, I think. I think it's one of the biggest
I've ever seen.
It's fun.
It's always an interesting time when you go do the race book at Foxwoods. Now you can also sports bet there as well now. As everyone knows, Foxwoods partnered with DraftKings. It's the DraftKings branded sports book there.
Yep.
Mohegan Sun partnered with FanDuel. They have the sports book. It's located in the Mohegan Sun Casino's Bow and Arrow Sports Bar.
I have no earthly idea where that is. I've been to Mohegan Sun several times. I have no idea where the Bow and Arrow Sports Bar is. Sports bar? Did they call it a sports bar?
Yes.
I have no idea.
Well,
Mohegan Sun, if anyone's never been there, they have a casino. And then it's like this area with shops, and they have a great Irish bar too. I forgot the name of it, but they have a really good Irish bar there.
I have to admit, I love the ceiling in Mohegan Sun, where it's got some of the night sky up there.
It's
well done.
I like Mohegan Sun better than Foxwoods. Foxwoods is bigger because it's huge, but you know,
and they
Mohegan
also have
Sun,
that huge bingo center too in Foxwoods.
But Mohegan Sun, I think, is a nicer looking casino.
Well, they had an official ribbon-cutting ceremony on the 30th, and Governor Ned Lamont was the honorary first bet of the state's sports betting industry. He placed a $50 bet on the Connecticut Sun to cover the spread against the Chicago Sky.
That's WNBA.
Yep. Then he headed to the Rainmaker Casino side of Foxwoods, where DraftKings had their opening ceremony.
All right.
It actually kind of... After the fact, a lot of people were kind of scratching their heads at this, and I thought it was kind of funny because a lot of states, like when Golden Nugget first launched sports betting, they're owned by Fertitta.
Tillman Fertitta, yeah.
Who also owns the Houston Rockets.
Yes. We're not allowed to bet on the Houston Rockets.
Golden Nugget was not allowed to take any bets.
Yes.
On any Fertitta-owned sports teams.
Yeah.
Houston Rockets. But here we have Mohegan Sun taking a bet on the Connecticut Sun.
Which, by the way, play at Mohegan Sun.
And is owned by Mohegan Sun.
So
I'm
a little bit of a controversy. I guess they're going to have to work that out and see how that goes.
A lot of the lawmakers said they'll address that in the next legislative session.
I mean, fair is fair. I mean, if we can't bet on the Houston Rockets at the Golden Nugget, you know, especially I was in New Jersey and I couldn't. There was Houston Rockets weren't even on the board. But, yeah, no, it's
It'll be interesting
to
see how they address it.
Connecticut does and what they address it.
I mean, right off the bat, their answer, the casino's answer was, well, FanDuel's running the sports book.
Okay, yeah.
So, I mean, I guess that's a good answer.
Yeah, I guess so. You know, well, it'll be interesting to see how, I guess the state legislature is going to take a look at that.
In the next session, yeah. Okay. They said they're going to address that because it seemed to have gotten through the cracks there a little bit.
Yeah, yeah.
Just to tie a bow on it. $50 bet won. The Sun won the.
So the governor won.
The governor won.
Wow! Congratulations, governor.
So congratulations to Connecticut. They are the 27th state, plus you have DC. So I guess 28th jurisdiction. I guess you want to call it that. Now, 116 million Americans have access to legalized sports betting.
Hmm.
So that's adding to the sports betting industry. Before we move on to some interesting numbers. I want to stay in Massachusetts to talk about what's going on with their sports betting.
Nothing's going on with their sports betting. Absolutely nothing is going on with their sports betting.
You can actually
Did I tie a bow on that one?
You can actually make a case that Massachusetts just announced they're not going to have sports betting this year.
Well,
if you want to read into it.
They're not
going to
have it next year either by the
time. Well, no,
they're
going to have it next year. They got to have it next year. I mean, you have Connecticut now, Rhode Island, New Hampshire. I think Maine is closer to sports betting than Massachusetts right now. They're going to be surrounded and losing so much money.
The Encore Boston Harbor Casino, which is right outside of Boston, they just opened up the WynnBET Sports Bar. They're hoping to make that into a sports book. They even have the windows ready. I saw pictures of it. They have windows ready for them to take bets, but still, the state is dragging its feet.
Well, you also have MGM Springfield. They're building two sports bars. One of them's going to be the sports book.
Yeah, absolutely.
So everyone's ready to go.
They could start next week if you just they can train people to take bets, and boom, they can start next week.
And if you think about it, you also have the slot parlor, Plainridge.
Plainridge, yeah.
They just had two representatives of the state introduce legislation to try and expand that. So they have more table games.
Which, by the way, they're Penn National, which also means Barstool Sports.
And if you've been to Plainridge lately, you will see Barstool symbols everywhere.
Sure, sure.
So, and they have this one place in the middle, it used to be the Flutie Sports Bar or whatever the hell.
Well, I'm not sure if that's completely closed or that's just going to reopen.
It's still currently closed.
What it is. So who knows what that's
going to be. But let me tell you something. The way that is set up, that's a beautiful sports book because it's got the wall of video. Like every other sports book.
But like I said, if Flutie's still there, it's still the restaurant.
But what I want to hit was what the Senate president told reporters. Karen Spilka, the Senate president for Massachusetts, told media outlets that the chamber won't consider sports betting this year unless it determines that it has the bandwidth.
I don't even know what that
kind
means.
Kind of a weird choice of words. I mean, bandwidth.
It's a really weird statement.
It's one of those things where she's got her own priorities, and she wants to focus on the election reforms that are going on in the state, redrawing of political district lines, which seems to be a very hot topic up there.
Sure.
So there's a whole bunch of different things she wants to hit before she even starts talking about sports betting. She also made an interesting comment. She doesn't feel Massachusetts needs the extra money.
Okay, well, whatever. I don't know what they're thinking, but I think it's going to be a couple years for Massachusetts.
I don't know. I hope it's been getting closer and closer and closer. I mean, I remember, what was it, earlier this year we were talking about,
I know the governor
14
wants it.
Different bills.
Yeah, I know the governor wants it.
The governor came out and had his own bill.
He wants it there. So now, around Massachusetts, there's to the north is New Hampshire. They have sports betting. To the
south. Possibly Maine next year.
Well, I'm just saying who has it right now. New Hampshire has it right now. Rhode Island has it right now. Connecticut has it right now. You know how much money Massachusetts
and if
is
you
losing?
And if you want to even throw in, you're going to have, like I just said, Maine possibly, but you also have New York State, which is on the other border of Massachusetts, the western border.
Yeah, well, yeah.
So they're going to be surrounded.
Well, New York has sports betting, too. I mean, they have retail sports betting. So,
that's all the way on the other side of the state. I'm talking about once they get that mobile sports betting going, which, by the way, looks like it may not be ready by this football season, may not even be ready by Super Bowl. They may be going at light speed. But we'll see exactly when they get that. That's going to be an interesting state to watch once they have that.
My point is Massachusetts is losing huge sums of money by their citizens going out of the state to place a bet.
Massachusetts is surrounded by sports betting, and they need the money, too. I don't care what she said.
They're an oasis of stupidity. That's what they are.
Before we leave the launching of industries here, remember how we always talk about Mississippi not having mobile sports betting?
Yeah.
They now have mobile sports betting.
All right. Great.
Sort of.
What's that mean? You have to be on the property?
The Gold Strike Casino Resort in Tunica, Mississippi now offers mobile sports betting on their property.
Okay. See, I get that.
BetMGM is now live in Mississippi.
That's amazing how they do that. The geolocation has come such a long way since New Jersey started with the online casinos in 2013, I think it was, where the geolocation was a mess. I always told the story where in one room of my house I can play online in New Jersey, but another room of my house I couldn't play online in New Jersey. Right now the geolocation technology is such where they can pinpoint where you are and there's absolutely no problems with it. Yeah, good. But it's a good step for Mississippi, though.
Well, I hope we're going to start seeing a lot more of this because Mississippi is one of the last holdouts for sports betting. They just have retail only. This is the first mobile. I'm wondering when they're going to
technically call it. I guess technically you can call it mobile, but it's not. You have to be on the property. I mean, you can't sit from your couch at home.
You can be in your hotel room.
But you have to be on the property.
Yeah. So. If you're out, running around Mississippi, you just want to place a bet.
Just tooling around
Mississippi. You might want to do that. So one other little announcement regarding upcoming sports betting launches. Baltimore's Horseshoe Casino announced that their first floor of the building will be converted into a next-level entertainment environment. Sportsbook branded by the recently launched Caesar Sportsbook, as well as a new brew pub.
Wow, they use these marketing terms that I love. What was it called? Entertainment what?
Entertainment environment.
Okay, all right.
Yeah, it's basically a...
you're going to get a sportsbook and a bar.
Yeah, that's basically what it is.
You're getting that.
Well, it's on the gaming floor.
I know.
Kind of interesting. So we'll see what happens.
Gotta sell it.
It's another one of those states where they're getting ready, closer and closer to a launch, which is cool to see.
Yep.
Let's go back to some of the numbers that we teased at the beginning of the segment here. We had Nevada, Rhode Island, New Hampshire, and Tennessee all release their August numbers. Kind of some interesting little tidbits from each state. First of all, the online handle in Nevada was almost 70% this month. And
it's very good for Nevada.
You don't normally see that. I mean, you were seeing it during the pandemic because the casinos were closed and you couldn't go to the sports books. But 70% in a normal open casino environment, that's kind of interesting for Nevada. I'm wondering if more and more people are getting used to the mobile betting there, or is it the influx of visitors using the mobile betting?
Well, it's vacation time, so this is August, right? There's a lot of vacations there, and so people probably are trying it out. So,
well, going back over to the East Coast, we had Rhode Island and New Hampshire both released their numbers for the month of August. Kind of interesting win rate here for Rhode Island. The August win rate of 4.7%. That's what the sports books held on to. It's also called the hold. The August 4.7% win rate on gross gaming revenue for Rhode Island in August was the first monthly sub 5% hold in any state since the Super Bowl.
Hmm. Okay.
And actually, Rhode Island was one of the ones that had a sub 5% hold rate for the Super Bowl.
So does that translate into Rhode Island bettors are smarter? you know, they're the sports books in Rhode Island aren't keeping their money. They're paying out big bets.
Well, it could go, you know, you could look at it either way. I mean, it was a slow month.
I know it's a slow month, but some bettors made some wise bets, and Rhode Island sportsbooks didn't hold on to their money.
Well, if you want to look at it from the revenue side, they had a 65% decrease in their revenue from July to August. Yeah. So if you want to make the case they have smarter bettors, for it.
Well, and
I would not make that case.
In August, it's less bets too, as well. But maybe the bets they took were really good ones for the bettors.
And over in New Hampshire, or up in New Hampshire from Rhode Island. The New Hampshire revenue for the month of August broke their 5-month streak of $3 million plus in revenue every month. They had 5 months straight of $3 plus million.
Well, look, August is a slow month, The Red Sox had their collapse in August, so they weren't a smart bet for New Englanders during that month. So, everything kind of settled down up there.
One last note regarding the sports betting numbers for August. We have on the national scene, and this is without Illinois reporting their numbers, so take this one with a grain of salt. New Jersey led August with an overall handle of $664.7 million. Nevada was second with $427.4 million. Then you have Pennsylvania, Indiana, and Michigan rounding out the top five.
Isn't this a typical lineup every month? It seems like this is kind of like every month. It's New Jersey, Nevada, Pennsylvania, Michigan.
Well, Michigan's kind of new.
I'm waiting for Michigan to overtake Pennsylvania.
Well, you got to wait to see exactly where Illinois falls in August, too.
Yeah,
so Illinois is consistently at least 30 days late compared to these other states in releasing their monthly numbers. So this is without Illinois reporting their numbers. Again, there is a big gap between New Jersey. Then you have Nevada and Pennsylvania. They're always close to each other.
Yeah, it's almost like a $200 million gap between New Jersey and Nevada.
I'm waiting for Pennsylvania to consistently beat Nevada because it seems to be coming.
Yeah, they're getting. Yeah, Pennsylvania's edging closer to Nevada, so.
So those are
It would be interesting to see New Jersey, Pennsylvania as the top two one of these months.
I think you're going to start seeing New Jersey, Illinois at some point.
Mm-hmm.
If some of these other states come in, New York is going to be interesting to watch.
New York, when they get mobile, that's going to be a monster.
And we still got Florida coming.
Yep.
I mean,
yep.
Their retail sports betting is still scheduled to start October 15th, but the online is the one that's being sued upon, and they just had a new lawsuit filed there. So there's going to be further delays with that online sports betting launch, I think. But again, Florida should be interesting to watch in terms how good their retail sports betting industry is going to be, because you're going to be launching soon.
Yeah.
They're going to get at least half a month of October here.
And you know what? They're a warm weather state, so you're going to get vacationers down in the wintertime, and they're usually go to the retail book. So, they should make a dent in the national market.
Well, let's move on to some deals that we have had the past week here. I'll tell you, even if it was a slow week in the sports betting industry, it's still a ton of deals to talk about. And it's kind of weird when it feels slow, but it's not, and I think that's probably going to be the case moving forward here, because a lot of the, I think at the beginning of the football season, there was a lot of frenzy.
Yeah.
And now it's starting to calm down again. Maybe you get used to a little bit of a bump in the activity, but there's still a ton of stuff to talk about. First of all, congratulations to Joe Asher. He is now the president of sports betting for IGT.
Yes.
Asher was the head of William Hill US before that company was sold to Caesars. He left, and now he is running the sports betting division for IGT. IGT has that Play Sports platform.
Yep.
So it'll be interesting to see where he takes IGT now, because he is one of the best in the business.
Sure.
Speaking of other deals, we have BetMGM making a couple deals. We have BetMGM bringing on mixed martial arts journalist Ariel Helwani as their brand ambassador. He's going to be doing everything MMA for them, content-wise. Okay. And they did another partnership with a podcast network, which is kind of interesting, sort of outside the box. They did a content partnership with comedian Bill Burr and All Things Comedy. which is his podcast, comedy podcast network.
Okay.
You wouldn't think about it, but it's kind of an interesting idea. They're doing a podcast called Anything Better.
Okay, all right.
Yeah, so, you know, they're going to be doing that, and they're going to have a Monday morning podcast and their YouTube channel incorporating BetMGM branded spots and commercials, all that stuff.
Great.
FanDuel announced a market access deal with the Port Madison Enterprises to operate sports betting in Washington State. Retail Sportsbook is going to be opening this fall. Online sports betting following whenever the regulations allow.
Great.
This is interesting. Gambling.com just announced their first ever sports betting ambassador.
Okay.
They did a deal with former NFL Pro Bowl defensive end Sean Merriman.
Huh, okay.
He's going to be doing sports betting picks and analysis for them throughout the NFL season. Yeah, I haven't heard from Sean Merriman in
a while. No. Wow.
And I actually had a chance to read his first column.
Okay.
And very good. Very, very good information regarding some of the sports betting stuff.
Hmm, okay.
Going over to MaximBet. MaximBet did an interesting deal.
I have yet to take a look at MaximBet. I've been hearing about it constantly these last couple of weeks. So, are they live in Jersey and stuff?
No. Yet.
Okay, maybe that's why I'm not hearing.
They are live in Colorado. They have market access everywhere in another five states.
Okay.
So, but the in Colorado, they made an interesting offer here. This deals with the name, image, likeness stuff going around with college sports lately.
Okay.
They are offering all female student athletes at Division I, II, and III colleges and universities in Colorado a name, image, and likeness deal that rewards them with cash, invitations to parties, merchandise, all for MaximBet.
Wow. Okay.
So that was kind of good. I'm waiting to see more sports books do something like this. I'm wondering why they haven't been doing this. I mean, Colorado's, they had a university do a deal with PointsBet, but no one's done the NIL deals yet other than MaximBet. Maybe because of the magazine, they're thinking outside the box kind of stuff.
Yeah, no, it's a good idea.
And one last note to talk about before we get out of here for the week. The Chicago Bears have entered into an agreement to purchase Arlington Park from Churchill Downs.
Wow, okay.
As everyone knows, they want a new field. Basically, mm-hmm. They play at Soldier Field right now.
Yep.
Arlington Park is almost 20 times larger than Soldier Field.
Really? I didn't know it was that big.
The overall park itself.
Oh, yeah, I know that. I didn't know it was that much bigger. I know it was bigger, but I didn't know it was that much bigger.
The deal is worth $197.2 million. And the reason they did this deal is because of sports betting. They're not getting any traction for getting any kind of sports betting at Soldier Field. So they want out of Soldier Field.
Huh,
it's a new facility. It's got sports betting attached. Remember, they just did that deal with Rivers Casino, where Rivers Casino is not only the official casino, but it's also the official sports book of the team.
Mm-hmm.
Rivers already has deals in place with Arlington Park.
Okay, all right.
So there's a little connection right there. And also Churchill Downs has a majority stake in Rivers Casino anyway. So that kind of explains a lot of the maneuvering going on there. The Bears still have to deal with their lease with Soldier Field. The Soldier Field lease doesn't expire until 2033.
Oh, okay.
So, but in 2026, they can do a one lump payment of $84 million to get out of it.
That's probably what they're going to do if they're really serious about this.
So we'll see exactly what happens with that. One last note before we get out of here. Betfred announced a partnership with an online entertainment network called The Game Day.
All right.
I have to go check this out because I was not familiar with The Game Day. It's a network with two shows, Ride With and Take the Points.
Okay.
So betting shows that are going to be sponsored by Betfred Sports.
I just saw a new betting show last night called Betting Exchange in the New York market. So they're playing off.
Is that off MSG?
I think it was MSG. I think it was. It was they played off the stock exchange. They had a section called the portfolio and things like that. They wanted to play off the stock exchange kind of motif.
Well, Nasdaq's getting into it, especially with that deal they did with Sport Trade.
Yep.
Which, by the way, is a betting exchange. So that's another term for
that. Exchange, a new show in New York.
Well, that's it for this week. There's plenty of other stories to talk about. We've got the print version of the Turnpike Sports Book Report coming up on the blog after this show is released. Just head on over to turnpikesportsradio.com and click on the blog button, and you'll see the full stories of what we just talked about, as well as a lot of stories we did not have a chance to talk about this week. So
yes, it's on, Doug, by the way, it's on MSG Networks.
MSG.
So, yes.
All right. Who's the any sportsbook sponsor for it?
I didn't see a sportsbook sponsor for it.
Wouldn't be surprised if it's NASDAQ.
a former Jet was doing it. I can't remember the name of the former Jet. So is it Coleman?
Eric Coleman.
Eric Coleman. Yep, that's it. Eric Coleman, former Jet, is on Betting Exchange. It was a pretty good show.
Well, he's actually pretty good on camera.
He is very good. Well, that'll do for us this week. We'll see you next time on the Turnpike.